From Orange, Massachusetts, the Sunday Sports Spectacular presents the World Parachute Jumping Championships. Brought to you by Ford, maker of the Econoline van, the truck idea of the year, and four complete lines of fine cars, America's liveliest, most carefree cars. And by Vitalis with V7. Vitalis keeps your hair neat all day without grease. And by Schlitz, the beer that made Milwaukee famous simply because it tastes so good. For real gusto and a great light beer, get together with Schlitz.
This is Logan International Airport in Boston. Arriving here are parachute jumpers from 24 foreign countries. These teams will travel 75 miles to the little town of Orange, Massachusetts, where some 200 men and women will take part in a month-long contest, the 6th World Sport Parachuting Championship. It will be the first contest of its kind ever held in the United States. Customs quickly clears the baggage, and the visitors board buses to ride along Boston's Freedom Trail. For many of these newcomers, it's their first trip to the United States. And historic Massachusetts, where the American Revolution started, is a great place to see America first. The international group makes friends quickly. These Skybirds have a club all their own. A world fraternity of parachuters, they have a thousand things to talk about and countless experiences to share. The caravan soon reaches Orange, where the R.C. Mayer High School students have renamed their school Friendship Lodge for the visitors' stay. The American hosts have worked hard and long to make their new friends feel at home. United States Army Captain Perry, one of the judges, leads the welcome. There are handshakes and smiles and offers to help in every way. The meet is off to a good start, and soon we'll see some of its greatest moments. Ours continue to be ones of getting acquainted, getting prepared, and getting established. Trilingual signs in English, French, and Russian carry all the news. More important, team captains, interpreters, and representatives of all the competing countries hold a meeting. The details of the coming meet are carefully explained by the jump director, who advises the visitors on rules, regulations, judging, and the calendar of events. All pay careful attention. These parachutists will compete in exciting contests that will be judged by fractions of a meter and split seconds in time. Understanding exactly how and why decisions will be made and winners picked is most important. No one wants any later arguments, particularly in 24 languages. For the present, all seem like good candidates for an international peace conference. Below is the target, the Paris Stadium at Orange Airport. And here come the shootists carrying the insignia and flags of 24 nations. Gathered on the sloping sides of an earthen bowl 300 meters across, thousands of spectators watch. Now the contestants stand in line across the big bowl. So let's take a look at some of these Skybirds from 24 lands. Czechoslovakia has sent a strong team. So have the French, world pioneers in sports shooting. West Germany. Great Britain. The Americans. In the front, Gerald Borquin, Phil Vanderweg, Jim Arender, Loy Bryden, and Carolyn Olsen, Kay Emmons, Muriel Simbrough, Nona Pond, Helen Lord, and Gladys Inman. This is our host team. Here under the mast flags is Dick Fortenberry, a top U.S. contestant. The teams exchange pennants and good luck is repeated in many languages. U.S. team leader Deek Sonicson makes the traditional pennant trade with the Soviets. The ceremony ends while man's best friend rests. One more big job before the actual meet begins. Acquaint foreign pilots and jump masters with the lay of the land and the flight rules around Orange, Massachusetts. Many foreign teams have their own pilots, and Nate Pond, chief U.S. pilot at the Wright, himself a veteran sport shootist, fills in the others on the regulations and flying characteristics of the United States planes being used. None of the foreign pilots will actually take off or land, but they will be at the controls when their teammates jump. So each pilot gets a full checkout. That's the big bowl from the air. In the center of the airport's three runways, Nate Pond has every flyer handle the plane from the pilot's side. This is the same side from which the jumpers take off. Since all are veteran pilots who have been training with their teams for a long time, it's not hard to check them out. Also, like Pond, many are sport shootists, and this gives them just the kind of judgment needed for the coming events. Time to land, so Nate gets back into the pilot's seat. Sport parachutists most always pack their own chutes. For their use, supply and storage tents have been set up on the airfield. Jim Arender, one of America's top jumpers, lends a helping hand to a visitor. The packing job of lines, gores, sleeves, and pilot chute requires attention and care. Each jumper does his own, and it is this that helps make this sport extremely safe. These Soviet women are checking each other's equipment. Officials, judges, and contestants keep the tent area alive with shop talk. Interpreters are everywhere to help exchange information. For the World Championship is more than a competition. It's where you can learn the latest techniques as practiced in many lands. Here are the Bulgarians. The last World Championship was held in their capital city of Sofia in 1960. Now they, too, are keeping up to date with the help of an interpreter. Out in the center of the ball, the target is clean. All is ready for the first practice jumps. In this meet, the men will make 16 precision jumps and the women 12. They will be judged both as individuals and as teams. The art of precision jumping is based on three things: timing of your exit, the position of your body in space, and finally, your ability to maneuver after the parachute opens and you are floating down to Earth. Here you go. A jump from 1,000 meters, about 3,300 feet. Now other jumpers carefully pick their exit position. Wind velocity and direction are important facts to consider. In less than 10 seconds, you must pull the ripcord, and if you're in the right spot, you'll be on target. The smoke acts as a guide and helps give wind direction. Let's take another look. As you hang in the air, that target looks very small. With the chute open, swaying makes control even harder. But the skilled parachutist never loses sight of that tiny disc in the center. Closer and closer. Closer and closer. And it's a near miss. The way to steer with a conventional chute is to use the risers and turn yourself in the direction you want to go. There are many finer points to consider, such as your rate of descent and forward motion, plus wind direction and velocity. It's hard to catch on when you start, but later it becomes second nature. The prizes go to each man, woman, and team earning the highest score in 3 out of 4 jumps for men and 2 out of 3 for women. Some try swinging like a pendulum to get closer. Others come down straight and take a hard fall to get that extra centimeter. Judges and marking teams record each result immediately. Overall standings of the teams and contestants are electronically computed. The idea is simple, but the sport is difficult. All you have to do is hit a tiny target from almost a mile away. Soon we'll see one of the main events. So the 6th World Sport Parachuting Championship starts, and more people come to enjoy the thrills. It's a space-age sport, but around the airport, it's an old-time carnival, complete with all the trimmings that make Johnny and Jane so happy at the fair. There are helpful salesmen with helmets and goggles, all to make Junior look like the real thing. Mothers and babies hold their own parade. It's a fine New England picnic with flags flying high and colorful visitors from many lands. It's not only a great day for the spectators, but for 2 local people who we discovered are very much a part of the competition.
We'd like you to meet a husband and wife team, a combination who are members of the United States team competing here at Orange, Massachusetts, the Ponds, Nate and Nona. Is this a family discussion or can anybody interrupt?
Well, we're just discussing the exit point here, Jack.
Nate, Nona, this is a rather obvious question, but which of the two of you got interested in this sport first?
Well, Nate did. He's been jumping for much longer than I have.
And was it a case of you either being a parachute sport widow or joining?
It was definitely a case of joining it.
And how long ago was that?
My first jump was in 1958. I made 2 jumps then and didn't really start seriously jumping until this spring. We've had several children in between here.
How many do you have?
We have 4 right now.
Well, would you hope that your children became sport parachuters?
Well, I'm going to leave it completely up to them, but our oldest boy is counting the years till he's 16.
I mean, you would have no reservations on letting him do it?
Absolutely not, if he wanted to.
Nona, does it make you feel safer knowing your husband's driving the plane, piloting the plane?
Well, I certainly feel secure in his ability. He's a very good pilot on top of being an excellent jumper, and it helps a great deal in the air to have someone who knows exactly what they're doing.
Well, Jack, we've got to go right now. They seem to be waiting for us to get started on this next jump.
Well, it's certainly been nice meeting you, Ponds, and we wish you the best of luck and also the little ones you have at home, and we'll be watching this jump. Good luck now.
The championship events begin with the women's 1,000-meter individual precision jumps. There will be a delayed opening of up to 10 seconds permitted, and there's the target about 3,000 feet below. Ilona Berger of Canada goes out. Marcia Barich of Yugoslavia. Teresa Leclerc of Canada. And Russia's Shnitova. Here is Miss Barich of Yugoslavia landing. She's one of the best, and we'll meet her later. Down from the sky comes Miss Shnitova of the Soviet Union. She swings wide and sits down hard. By no means her best jump. Here's Kathy Henderson of Australia. This looks like a pretty good jump. The Bulgarian women rank with the world's best jumpers. This is Miss Vasileva. Next, Subova of the Soviet Union. The winner is decided, not by one jump, but by her best 2 out of 3. A stand-up landing, but it's meters off. Krawczewska of Poland oscillates wildly in an effort to hit the target. ...6.06 meters. Miss Anguilova of Bulgaria. Notice how she pulls on the risers to guide herself closer to the mark, working for every centimeter. Our next paralady is Todorova of Bulgaria. Not bad, less than 4 meters off. Russia's Maslova works her chute efficiently, but not well enough to beat the impressive jumping of Czechoslovakia's Koldova and Stancikova. Less than 2 meters. While watching, one gains great respect for the courage and skill of all parachuting girls. And to find out more about them, I had a talk with one of them.
And now here is one of the most outstanding women jumpers in the world, Maria Barić of Yugoslavia. Maria, how are you?
Very well.
Are you married?
No, I'm not.
How old are you?
20 years.
20 years old, and how many jumps have you had?
Now I have 210.
Well, you must have started when you were much younger, did you? How old were you when you started to parachute?
18 years.
18 years old. Where do you live in Yugoslavia?
In Zagreb, the capital of Croatia.
The capital city of Zagreb. Is your style different than, say, the American style or the French style?
I don't understand what you said.
The way you jump. The way you perform your maneuvers in...
Knot.
In other words, the way you jump, Maria Barić jumps, is it the same as all over the world, or do you have a particular way?
No, I have no any particular way. It is the same.
Well, we certainly like to wish you a lot of luck. Is this your first trip to America?
Yes.
Are you seeing enough of the United States?
No.
Well, we hope you have a little more chance after the competition's over, and we'll be watching with great interest how you do. Thank you very much, Maria.
Okay, thank you.
Someone once said that modern man's ultimate pleasure is simply that of controlled speed. You find this in flying, skiing, and racing. You also find it in sport parachuting. No two jumpers will give you the same description of what it's like to soar through the sky. That it is a beautiful and delightful thing, all will agree. The silence and the sheer pleasure of a free fall is like nothing else. And to these jumpers, it is touched with a challenge. Each man starts equally and must react to similar iron laws of physics. Each needs all his knowledge and training to win. Once you pass the initial apprehensions of a first jump and learn how really safe sport parachuting is, your fears vanish and your joy begins. Parachuting safety has been proved by many thousands of jumps. Most people simply don't understand that the real lure of sport parachuting is its unbelievable fun. Man doesn't live on Earth, he lives within it. And the air around us offers a vast new playground, greater than the ocean. Here you can find a new world in this new sport. In a free fall, you become as buoyant as a fish in the sea. The air becomes a fluid cushion that you can feel and in which you can move in three dimensions. Its rapture grips all who've ever tried it. From your floating height, 2,000 feet above the earth, you hang in the sky and steer yourself at will, as below you can view a passing landscape of lakes and fields and forests. After that first landing, all you will want to do is jump again. And in competition jumping, there is excitement and the healthy discipline of training to win. But there is also jumping and soaring just for fun. The quiet of the sky and the freedom of the air are things that we can only experience, but not truly describe. It is a feeling of space and limitless time beyond our power to comprehend. Such is the world of the sport parachutist as he falls alone in his own great ocean of air. Finally, as always, you will return to the world from which you came, and you return with reluctance and sadness. Sadness that another jump has ended. Now, in a moment, we'll return to the World Sport Parachuting Championships.
We're at the United States tent talking to the first alternate member of the United States parachute team, Mr. Hank Simbrough. Hank, how many jumps have you had?
Well, at the present time, Jack, I have in excess of 650 jumps.
And how long did it take you to acquire that many?
Well, actually, 2 years. I feel this is a fairly short period.
Gotta say, you must have jumped from morning till night.
Well, we did. We jumped 3 days a week on an average, about 15 to 20 jumps in preparation for this.
How much time does it take while you're learning to be a sport parachuter? In other words, does your job suffer from it? Are you away from home a lot?
Well, you are, definitely. But in this case, my wife and I, and Jack, I would like you to meet my wife, Muriel Simbrough.
I'd like to very much. Muriel, how are you? Jack Whitaker, it's awful nice to see you. Was he away an awful lot while he was doing these 650 jumps?
I don't believe so, because I was right there, too.
Hank, had you been a pilot before you started this?
Yes, Jack. Muriel and I both flew for approximately 3 years before we started jumping.
Did you fly him while he jumped?
Yes. Approximately 4 months to the day.
Oh, well, maybe that's how you got interested in it, huh?
Could have been. It looked so exciting, I figured I must be missing something.
And you knew a little bit about it then before you started?
Well,
from watching Hank.
To the point of watching, I think I acquired an awful lot of knowledge that helped me tremendously. In listening to the fellas talk about how to get in and out of maneuvers and, you know, things of difficulty that I never encountered by listening, which helped me.
What is this? I've been noticing these around here in number...
Actually, Jack, this is the pilot chute. This is the first contrivance that comes out of the parachute once the ripcord has been pulled. When the chute is packed, it's compressed into positions such as that, and as soon as the ripcord is released, this is the first thing that flies up, and then the wind catches it and pulls out the sleeve and the parachute.
Where it makes it easier for the chute to open, opens it quicker?
Right.
But I imagine it does take a little sacrifice and a little giving up of some things to compete, doesn't it?
It does, my children.
Yeah, how many do you have, Muriel?
I have two daughters, Jessie, 13, and Jamie, 10.
Well, I hope Mommy brings them back a nice big championship cup after this competition.
So too.
Thank you very much, Simbrough. It was a pleasure meeting you.
Thank you.
We go back to the sky for the women's precision group jump. Three jumpers make up a team, and here are the Bulgarian women as their parachutes open and they try to line themselves up on the target. What makes things harder is that you've got to space yourselves carefully apart. This is called getting into a stack or line. It has to be done right so that you can concentrate on the target instead of struggling to keep out of each other's way. Miss Vasileva comes in for the first landing. It looks like a good one. It is 3.95 meters. Here is Miss Todorova. 6.99. And third, Miss Anguilova, who is now drifting over the target. 6.31 meters. It's a good team effort. The crowd watches intently as the Czechoslovakian women's team comes down in an almost perfect stack. A necessary formation for a good team jump because it enables second and third jumpers to evaluate the wind drift of the first and to make fine adjustments in time to better the team score. First to land is Miss Koldova. She's close to the target. 1.96 meters, a very fine jump. No, this is not a landing in a parking lot. These are the next two Czechoslovakian women shown from outside the bowl to give an idea of their perfect stacking. Three young ladies that make a good team. Here come the American ladybirds. Right now, they're leading with their first two jumps that give them a total of 1,121 points. Only the Russian women with a total of 1,014 points can hope to beat them. The Czech girls watch as Carolyn Olsen makes her approach. On her first jump, she was only 1.52 meters off center. She works the risers hard, straining for every advantage. Oh, a great jump. just 1.77 meters from dead center. And now Muriel Cimbro, with an earlier 3.73, comes in fast at a sharp angle. 4.62, a good score for the team effort. Ah, but here's trouble for number three. Nona Pond, with a sensational second jump of 1.15, is being blown wide of the mark. She weighs only 100 pounds, and a strong breeze carries her 70 meters off center. But the United States' chances are still good, since only the best two out of three jumps are scored.
Here is the American women's team, ladies and gentlemen. We'd like, you've already met Muriel Cimbro. Congratulations.
Hi,
and Carolyn Olson, congratulations.
Thank you.
Carolyn, how do you feel about it?
Well, it's windy out there, I'll tell you.
A little Nona's around here. Can you come up and take a look in our cameras?
I came close to blowing away, I'm afraid.
Yeah, well, how much do you weigh?
About 106.
Yeah. Well, you don't have it won yet, but just about. We understand the Soviets have to do just about a perfect one to beat you, so congratulations again, girls. Thank you very much.
Here comes the competition. Five young ladies from Russia, preceded by their pilot. Three will actually jump. The fourth is an alternate, and the fifth is a jump master. Miss Soldatse, Miss Maslova, Miss Subova, and Miss Shnitova. The USSR has the most sport parachutists in the world and is very serious about winning. In the last international competition, Miss Soldatse actually jumped with a broken leg in a cast. The girls are ready, but the Soviets let the pilot do the spotting. Now the word is go. Maslova is first. Shnitova is second, and Soldatse is third. The three white chutes dot the sky. They have the Russian variable side slots for precise control, particularly under low wind conditions. The girls have not lined up too well. Still, they have more experience than the other jumpers, and we must not underestimate their chances. This is Miss Maslova coming in. She is 9.81 meters off. Not bad, and they still have a chance. But both the next two ladies must be nearly perfect for the team to win. Here comes Miss Shnitova. She sits down hard at 10.14 meters. Now it's up to Miss Soldatse. A fine jump, but not enough to win. This time, it's a first place award for the United States women's team. At Friendship Lodge, the trophy case is a popular exhibit for the many parachutists using this modern high school as a hotel. Nona Pond and Dick Fortenberry of the United States would like to capture some of these. So would Miss Krachek and Mr. Rajewski of the USSR. This is the Men's World Champions Team Award, showing four precision jumpers and one style jumper in a free fall. There are individual awards, too, and awards for each event. These are beautiful trophies, and while a prize is only a symbol of the joy of winning, every contestant in this meet would love to take one home. Nona and Svetlana are no exceptions, as they eye the women's awards that closely resemble the men's. For the next few weeks, the girls will continue to try to win these prizes with all the skill and drive of the top athletes they are. Still, before all the winners are known, there will be a great many more jumps and a lot of planning to be done. Here, Deke Sonicson, an aeronautical engineer from California and former U.S. team member, talks over strategy with the American squad. The men have been practicing regularly for a month and are in peak form. But the precision jump for men that is coming up takes every bit of skill and stamina you have. It's a big one with more than 100 competitors, and Deke's advice is welcome. Listening closely are Phil Vanderweg, Jim Arender, and Gerald Borquin. Here is Dick Fortenberry and Loy Bryden. Team leader Sonicson knows the fellas are in good shape, and his best advice is thumbs up and take it easy.
The men's team contest is on. The jumper up there is Charnock of New Zealand, and his chute opens within the allotted 10 seconds. A delay in opening, even of a fraction of a second over, is a serious fault. To pick the right exit point for a perfect opening over your target is a must for a good score. Charnock makes his approach, but unfortunately for him, he's far off the target. Here's Adams of New Zealand. Note how quickly the judges work. This one measures only 3.4 meters to the center. Now Dawson of New Zealand is coming in. He's lost his jump boots, so today he uses tennis shoes. He landed 9.02 meters from the center. Out of this plane goes a Soviet jumper, Kiselyov. He comes in close, and the side vents in the Russian chute are now easy to see. Well done. Only 2 meters off. Here is Raevsky, another Russian, with an almost perfect jump. And now down comes teammate Kosikov, who tries to swing in, but lands 5 meters away. The last of the Russian team, Kochenko, heads straight for the target. The pin that marks the contact point is called the fichet. It is never moved until the measurements have been made and entered in the record books. The Russians have done very well, and their team is a happy one. Team competition is sharp, and the individual world championship is the hardest fought for. Every nation is in it, and each man must make 4 individual jumps during the 30-day meet. Here's a Korean, Kim Kwang-mo. Looking down, here are some of the problems to be solved for a good jump. Forward momentum of plane versus the air friction that slows you down. It works quicker the bigger you are. Then there's the wind velocity and drift effect during both free fall and with the parachute open. Here, Mr. Vershoek of the Netherlands comes down with the right answer. This is Don West of Australia, whose jump is off target. The gay checkered chute of Terence Daly of South Africa, who makes a good one, only 6.81 meters off. Yugoslavia's parachutists are among the world's best. And here's Marijan coming in. The judges must always work fast, but remain accurate to degrees of a centimeter, a fraction of an inch. Sasajima of Japan comes down to earth. Like Kim of Korea, he is an only contestant from his native land. Another lone entry is Vakaria of India. He proves to be one of the best and wins 15th place in the big event. Sasajima finds out that not all American youngsters are only baseball fans.
A glass of Schlitz, a friendly glass of Schlitz. Ruth with pride and just a kiss of the hops. To put real gusto into every drop. So let's get together with a glass of Schlitz. Real gusto in a great light beer. Thank you.
get together with Schlitz, the beer that made Milwaukee famous simply because it tastes so good.
Still they come. This is Zürcher of Switzerland. And while another one leaps, here is Zürcher's landing. Looks like a close one, not many meters off. Now Rougier of Switzerland. A nice final turn gets him very close. Still, the elusive dead center disc has not yet been hit. This is Offerman of the Swiss team. It's a rough one. And pretty far off. Best of the Swiss is Bergman. He gets a 3.75. There's the little plate, only 5 inches in diameter, that all these men are aiming at from a high-speed takeoff almost a mile away. This one is Maloney of Ireland, who makes a terrific effort. He's close. And the tapes give him 3.09 meters. Here's another Irishman, McLaughlin, who sits down in disgust at 15 meters. Hoffman of the Irish team has pulled his reserve chute because of a temporary malfunction. He'll be given another jump. Now with both chutes open, he's carried way off the target area. The contestants, as well as the audience, are kept informed of the details of the meet as it progresses. The Swiss and Irish team leave the field. Mr. Hoffman of the Irish team is none too happy. Now he has two chutes to pack instead of one. Well, that's all part of the contest, of which we'll view some truly startling jumps in a moment. In the air with the United States men's team. They've been working hard on precision. Gerald Borkman, poised in the door, has made one jump, only 1 meter off center, and now is ready for another try. Quickly, he makes his calculations. Personal air drag, wind drift, rate of fall, and he exits. Loy Bryden steps up next. One of his jumps hit the target. Another was just a meter away. He could be a winner. The pilot heads for the right spot. And he's off. This is Dick Fortenberry. He has two jumps under 3 meters. Next is Phil Vanderweg of the United States team. And finally, there's Jim Arender, a great all-around jumper. We follow him down until his parachute opens. Now for some other nations. This is Fernandez Sanchez of Spain. Camusat of Belgium. Shraga Tal of Israel. Shar, also of Israel. Patin of Belgium coming down and preparing to land. Competition is tough, and jumps like this, 11 meters off, are out of the running. This is Romania's top man, George Iancu. And here is England's Hughes, who makes a fine jump, followed by a rolling block on one of the officials. His jump was close, 3.08 meters. Navarro of Spain gives it the old college try. He kicks his legs hard to start a swaying motion that, timed correctly, will carry him on target. Good going. A fine effort by the Spaniard, who stops to give the judge the number he wears on his leg. Here's Kaplan of Czechoslovakia, one of the world's great jumpers. Wow. They'll take a careful look at this one. Kaplan's kind of curious, too. And for good reason. Almost dead center. And it's worth coming back for a closer look. There's some stiff competition building up. This is another ace, Galabov of Bulgaria. Watch him maneuver that chute and execute a split-second turnabout to drop straight in. It's a close one, and the judges work fast to keep up with the airborne traffic. Galabov was about 2 meters off. Israel has only men jumpers present. Here comes Evan of Israel driving in. An excellent try. And he keeps right on going. His parachute is still inflated and he runs after it to spill out the air. Gargala is Poland's leading accuracy jumper. Looks like he's heading straight for the center. It's a fine jump, and the marker says he was only a meter off. Here is Reed of Canada, and he appears to have the target lined up nicely. Wow, another beautiful jump. This is Reed's best so far, and it's sure hard not to smile when you've come that close to a perfect jump. Still they come, trying to hit that tiny circle. This is Trev of France on his last jump. Already he has a top score of 1.15 and 0.82. He could win the event. It looks good. And he did it. A zero for a perfect bullseye. He wins first place in the 1,000 meters individual precision jump for men. The crowd applauds him and his remarkable score that is 592.9 out of a possible 600. That's Trev in the center. He is happy. He's French, and he has some lovely teammates to help him celebrate. This is a popular win and well-deserved, for France was the birthplace of sport parachuting as we know it today. So it's congratulations by everyone for Georges Trev, world champion from France. No place can always have perfect weather, and Orange, Massachusetts is no exception. So, during part of August, the clouds and the winds called the turn. The tents were quiet, the weathermen made hopeful predictions, but the bad weather persisted, and contest judges were obliged to find other things to do. A soccer ball needs no introduction to this international crowd of healthy youngsters, since most of them have been playing the game since childhood. Put a group of finely trained international athletes together, provide a lull in the activities, and a soccer game is born. This is a good way for a sport parachutist to keep in shape. He can jump and stretch those muscles and do a lot of running around. Also in this local version, throwing the ball seems to be as acceptable as kicking. And now, probably inspired by Americans or Englishmen, the action looks like a mixture of football and rugby. A popular entertainer with the grounded Skybirds is a shaggy dog. He belongs to Lou Sanborn, a veteran sport parachutist and a pioneer in free-fall aerial photography. Whenever Lou wants to relax, he lets his dog take him for a ride. Or maybe he's training Blackie to drive out and pick him up after a jump. This is one wolf who should keep his eyes on the road. As a final bit of fun, Blackie does a solo performance. Lou Sanborn again with his motion picture camera mounted on his helmet. This is equipment and a type of film photography pioneered by Sanborn, and it's what has caught us some of our most exciting scenes and will bring us some even more extraordinary pictures of the events to come. After we're in the air, Lou will show us how it's done. First, the subject jumps. And then Lou follows him out. Here's a view of the plane as Lou and the camera drop away from it. Now he swings his camera down to get the man below. The film is taken in slow motion, while actually both Sanborn and the subject are dropping at over 100 miles per hour.
Then, as the contestant's parachute opens and slows him down, Sanborn zips right past him at continued high speed. Here's a view from the ground of Lou Sanborn coming in. And this is the approach as seen by Lou from up above. It gives us a little of the sensation experienced by the jumpers as they come in for a parachute landing. Of course, Sanborn always lands standing up, a practice not suggested for beginners. Here again is the man in the camera that has captured so much of the thrill and the wonder of sports parachuting on film. Now let's explore another major event coming up, style jumping. This strip of cloth, 30 meters long, intersects two Venetian blind-type signal arms. An operator can open and close these arms either singly or together to signal a jumper in the air. And he can give one of three different signals to tell the jumper which of the three standard style maneuvers to perform. After exit, the jumper must quickly stabilize in order to observe the signal, which is held for only 5 seconds. When he sees it, he starts the series. In this case, it's a cross-panel series. That is, a 360-degree turn to the right, one 360-degree turn to the left, and a back flip, and then again, right turn, stabilize. 360-degree left turn, stabilize, and a back flip. On the ground, five judges with assistants watch through binoculars and record the contestant's time in fractions of a second. The judging teams are spread out around the immediate area so that each one has a different point of view for observing and scoring the jumpers. None of the judges know the identity or nationality of the jumpers until after the scores have been submitted. Here's the panel operator again. He signals for a right series. Looking down, the jumper must catch this 5-second signal to his right. The contestant starts. 360-degree right turn. Now a full left circle. And a back flip. Once again, a right turn. A left turn. Flip. This completes a right series. Below, the panel operator gives another jumper a left series signal, while the judges keep their glasses trained and their stopwatches ticking. We've been seeing this event in slow motion, but actually the world's top style jumpers can do a complete series in less than 10 seconds from the time the signal is first flashed to them. What counts in this event is speed and style in the air. Precision landings are not part of the scoring. What do parachute jumping teams do when they're not in the air? In Orange, Massachusetts, during the 6th World Sport Parachuting Championship, many of them rested around the camp where their equipment was stored. Most teams were no different from the others, except for their flags. Under the Spanish emblem, we find Iberian humor and talents advertised for just about everything. New Zealand is proud of its kiwi bird and is a bit suspicious of this New England climate. In general, during rest periods, the camp is quiet, for the contestants must save their energy. Israel, Korea, and Japan share the same tent, and despite a slight language problem, are getting along fine. Like all sportsmen, they swap things, such as jumpers' patches, pins, and ideas. Back to the Spanish, whose signs seem to have attracted some visitors. They're trading pictures, but not of pinup girls or baseball heroes. These are photographs of jumpers in action, souvenirs that will be valued for many years ahead. Our international wanderings continued, and soon we found an attractive couple. While we have a lull in the jumping, while the judges have a meeting, we thought you might like to meet the captain of the Spanish team, Pipo Ayuso. I pronounced that right, Pipo?
Yes, very well.
And this is Miss Joyce Romanoff from Worcester, Massachusetts, who's going to act as our interpreter. You speak fluent Spanish. Where did you learn it, Joyce?
I started in college, and I spent the last year at the Sorbonne. I had quite a few Spanish friends.
I don't know who's having a better time here, Joyce or the Spanish team. You've quite captivated this whole area. You know that, people?
Yeah.
Que has captivo todo el mundo, que les gustas a todo el mundo aquí.
¿Por qué? Why?
You're having a lot of fun here.
Te ríes demasiado. Siempre es muy divertido.
Es mejor reírse que no estar serio, ¿no?
He says it's better than laughing to be serious.
It certainly is. How long have you been jumping?
¿Cuánto tiempo
saltas?
From 55.
How many jumps have you made?
¿Cuántos saltos?
1,200.
And you laugh all the time, hmm?
¿Ríes siempre?
Yes.
While you're jumping?
Yes, also.
Pipo, do you think parachute jumping will ever replace bullfighting as the number one sport in Spain?
Es que las paracaídas van a reemplazar los toros, las corridas en España.
Oh, that is impossible.
No, not possible.
Impossible.
Thank you very much, Pipo. It's a pleasure.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Joyce.
Thank you.
Back to the sky for highlights of an event that the crowd has been waiting for, the 2,000-meter men's style jumping. This height is roughly 1.25 miles. Here goes a jumper. He stabilizes and looks for the signal. It's a left panel for a left series. Left turn. Right turn. And back flip. Left turn, right turn, and back flip. And then a controlled swoop downward until the parachute opens. These pictures were taken at actual speed to give an idea of the tough job the judges have in making their point awards. Everything's ready for the next man. It's America's great stylist, Jim Arender, waiting to go, and Sanborn will follow him down. Here we go. His signal called for a right series, and at this time you can just barely see him at the top center of the screen. Our cameraman is diving straight down to get closer, and now you can begin to see some of Arender's stylish turns. And here is his final backward somersault. Now he spread eagles into a stable fall position. Time for a series, 10 2/10 seconds. We get ready for another air-to-air view of a style jump, while below, the crowd and the officials focus their own optical equipment. It's Romania's George Iancu. Our cameraman jumps. We do a turn and lose Iancu for a few seconds, but are now right back on him. Below us, Iancu is doing a right series. Every jumper receives 200 points for doing the series correctly, but it's the bonus points for the time that makes a winner. For every second under the allotted maximum of 25, you receive extra points. One problem is that at more than 100 miles per hour drop speed, you may over-control and lose time. Now in slow motion, we see Iancu complete his series. Right turn. Left turn. And backward somersault. To be completely fair, judges do not know in advance who the jumpers are, and all contestants wear white coveralls that look the same in the air. Average time recorded by all judges is used in the final decision. Let's see what this youngster is looking at. It's Canada's Darrell Henry, a fine stylist. He stabilizes perfectly and waits for the signal.
He sees that it's a cross panel, and he executes a full turn to the left. Now one to the right. A back somersault. And now the same turns, but in reverse order. First to the right. And then a left. Followed by the somersault. Darrell Henry's real time is 11.4 seconds. That wins him 43 bonus points. England's Colonel Wilson drops down. He is being signaled to do a left series. But he starts late and is given a penalty. That's bad luck, but it's all part of this very competitive sport. While this Englishman drops further and further down, we sense a feeling of unlimited space and silence, like that experienced by mountain climbers or astronauts in weightless orbit. In a general way, this may explain the growing appeal of this remarkable sport, of which we will see more in a moment. Style jumping from 2,000 meters, a little more than 1 mile up. Yugoslavia's best is Pavicevic. His cross panel performance is done in 12.7 seconds. Down, 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 and all the while performing with excellent control. There goes the chute, and he's on his way to see how the judges scored his style. The series of turns is decided by rolling a die. Not even the panel operator knows what's coming in advance. And once the jumper takes off, he must keep an eagle's eye on the panels from the time he leaves the plane. Those signals only last 5 seconds. Here goes Dick Fortenberry of the United States. His performance is good. The judges rated this performance for a total of 240.5 points, one of the meet's higher scores. Now it's Galibov, the Bulgarian. He, too, is given the signal to start a series to the right. Our diving cameraman catches the action in slow motion, while both he and his subject are falling at a terminal velocity of 120 miles per hour. The judges gave him 231 points. Judging takes a keen eye, strong binoculars, and a first-hand knowledge of the sport. Most judges are jumpers themselves. The man the judges are watching is Arasu of France, while from above, we enjoy a far better view with the help of our flying cameraman. As a spectator sport, it's one way to develop a squint and a suntan. Among the best in style jumping are the Russians. This is Kachenko. Now he sees the signal. It's a cross panel.
The judges timed him at 9.4 seconds, a top score of 253 points. With his first jump of 250, he should be world champion. The officials compare notes and check times. Averaging of scores is done by machines and carefully audited. With the figures tallied, the results, Arkachenko of Russia first, Arender of the United States second, Kazakov of Russia is third, Klima of Czechoslovakia is fourth, and Grevet of France is fifth. Dick Fortenberry of the United States is also in the top ten. The contest is over, and now some looks and words about the finale. A concluding banquet honors all those sport parachutists of the world who have come to Orange and who are about to return to their homes. They've spent nearly a month in competitions and worrying about the weather, but they've also spent that time in getting better acquainted with each other. And the friendships formed through the hours and days and weeks just past are as deep and as memorable as their profound loyalty to their unique sport of parachuting. Many of these relatively young people are already veterans of international competition, even though the first World Sport Parachuting Championship was held only a decade ago in Yugoslavia in 1951. Some of these men and women competed in the second World Championship held in Paris, at the third in Moscow, the fourth in Czechoslovakia, and the fifth in Bulgaria. America has been their host for the sixth great meeting, and 1964 will bring many of them together again. The magic of association, of attractiveness, and of common interest in sport parachuting has had a chance to cast its spell over everyone here. And their experiences in the little New England town of Orange, Massachusetts, will stay with them all their lives, no matter where they go, no matter how far away. A dance, a talk, a look, a new friend, an event, and countless unrecorded incidents will return to them in memories again and again. For theirs is a true communion of flight, of sport, and of friendship. But right now, the music starts to swing, and soon the muscles trained for jumping in the sky are hard at work on the earth. This is called the parachute hop, but its style is most definitely jitterbug. Finally, it's the twist, a world favorite in every crowd. The United States Army paratroopers show their form, but theirs is no monopoly. For now, with 30 tough days of training schedules and competition behind them, these contestants are really relaxed and ready for a jumper's frolic. It's certainly a well-earned evening of fun for some of the world's best sports. Now the dance is over and the night is complete. Tomorrow morning, there will be the closing ceremony.
Mr. King, the gentleman will meet you about 7.
Let's get together with a class of slits, a friendly class of slits. Real gusto in a great light beer.
Beer that made Milwaukee famous simply because it tastes so good.
On the closing day, the crack United States Army jumping team takes off to give a special demonstration above the international assemblage down in Orange's Para Theater. The military services, of course, have some of the finest parachutists. And the crowd sees some smoke-streaking, skydiving showmen. Actually, their aim is not simply to stunt, but rather to demonstrate the ease and mobility of tracking and pointing and doing relative work in the sky. They've got smoke flares attached to their feet, but they all make easy landings. The conclusion of the 6th World Sport Parachuting Championship takes place in the huge bowl just as the opening did. Team by team, the men and women march to the center of the arena while crowds cover its sloping sides of earth. America's Jacques Estelle, famous as a pioneer of this aerial sport in the United States, presides as first the winners of the women's individual 1,000-meter accuracy event are saluted. Miss Koldova of Czechoslovakia is first. Notice that third place is vacant, for Miss Vasileva of Bulgaria accepts her prize sitting down with a broken ankle. Miss Stancikova of Czechoslovakia is second. The men's individual accuracy jump champions at 1,000 meters are Treves of France first, Lloyd Bryden of the United States second, and Dick Fortenberry of the United States third. Treves was truly superb in winning this honor, but Bryden and Fortenberry trailed him by the smallest of margins. All three men rank among the finest sport parachutists in the world. Bryden is from Everett, Washington, and Fortenberry hails from Riverside, California. Now the women's group precision champions take center stage. America's team wins the first prize. Poland takes second place. And third place goes to the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. The Polish girls jumped with extreme precision and were a close second. The American women in this event proved a bit too tough to beat, and the Russian women fought right down to the final jump. Flags representing vastly different cultures fly side by side. Now the world's three top stylists. An American shares the victor's stand with two Russians. Kachenko of the Soviet Union wins the world's championship. Jim Arender of the United States is second, and Kazakov of the USSR takes third. The women's overall world champion, based on style and accuracy, is Muriel Simbro, our wonderful friend from Van Nuys, California. Second place goes to Koldova of Czechoslovakia, and third place to Nona Pond of New Salem, Massachusetts, who is overcome with emotion. Congratulations, girls. The men's overall world champion is also an American. The talented Jim Arender of Tulsa, Oklahoma, receives the top award, while Klima of Czechoslovakia is second, and America's Dick Fortenberry takes third. Overall team champion, the United States of America. Muriel Simbro, Carolyn Olson, Nona Pond, and Kay Emmons are joined by the girls from Czechoslovakia, who are second, and then by the three ladies from Poland, who win third place. Overall team champion is Czechoslovakia. The United States team of Fortenberry, Borkwin, Bryden, Arender, and Vanderweg places second. And the men's team of the Soviet Union takes third place. Americans have come a long way since they first began to compete in this great game of sport parachuting. The grand finale in Orange, Massachusetts, does more than just conclude the sixth World Sport Parachuting Championship, the first ever to be held in the United States. It marks the coming of age in this country of a new sport that is only beginning to capture the world itself. Good luck, good jumping, and goodbye.